Hey guys, this is Matthias, and this is a little how-to on how to replace a defective backup light switch on a Jetta, a Volkswagen Jetta TDI. This is a 2002 model, so I believe it's the MK4, and this is your L8, it's actually ALH engine, in case you would be wondering. What we're going after is a part that's actually pretty hard to reach. Let me actually just show you a little bit closer. This part is way under there. It's actually really hard to get to. And it's down there. You can actually see it there. This is the contact that you see. It's a pretty intricate area to get to. And in order to get there, you have to remove a number of components. So I have removed a number of components already here. The cover of the battery, which is right here, has been removed. There's a plastic part here that actually covers the back of the headlight, has been removed as well. And a couple of other things. There's a little piece of plastic here that has been removed as well that actually covers the wires, and it's like acting as a guide almost for the wires in the back of the battery. The battery clip itself, which is a little bit tired and it will get rusty. It's in this little spot here, which is pretty hard to get to. So I will put everything back together once I get to that point and kind of show you how to actually replace the contact. So I do have a new contact now, which I just got from a friend who works in a scavenging or in a graveyard. The place called the Volkswagen The Source. It's in the GTA. It looks like this. What usually happens with the things is that it will just stop functioning, or it will start working very intermittently. So normally when you press on it, your light should turn on, and when it's released, your light should go off. Well, at this particular time on my car, nothing works at all. Did some basic troubleshooting, checking the backup lights and everything, and it turned out to be this contact that's defective. So the repair is actually fairly easy. You start with removing the back of the light here. You need to basically remove the entire battery area in order to access this contact. It's pretty hard to reach. So before you get anything done, the easiest way is to actually disconnect the battery first. So I'm just gonna go ahead and do that. So loosen up the nut. You don't have to loosen up the nut on the top of the plus here, just the bottom. This is what actually releases the connector. So you remove the plus, you remove the ground, just shove it on the side here so that it's out of the way, not bothering you. And this whole assembly here lifts up. Now, in order to lift this up, you need to actually release the clips on both sides. So you have one clip here and one clip on that side. The two of them will release, and the whole thing will basically come apart. You lift it up, this will slide out, and the whole little carriage thing is gonna come off, right? So just set that aside for now. At that point, well, the battery should come loose, right? So you'll just grab the handles, if you have handles on your battery, just lift it up, and that thing should actually come off. It's not coming off right now because it's locked in the plastic case, and I think it's kind of locked in, really. There we go. Okay, take it out and set it aside. Remember the polarities, that's going to come handy after that. Now, the bottom of this, let me just actually get a little closer here, you'll find four bolts. So these are 10 size, so it's a 10 bit you'll be using. You can use one of these. They tend to be really tight because it is holding the battery in place, and this is actually tied up to the engine bay, right? So it's mine were actually really like almost corroded. I had a hard time taking them out. You can use some WD-40 to loosen them up if it's really too tight. And I took two out already that I left them. I left them there just to put them back when I had the part, and just got the part today. So I've grabbed the screws, set them aside again. Just gonna set them here. And there you go. And then that thing here should come off. So you might actually have to wiggle it a little bit. I'm just gonna put this back on the tripod here because it's a little hard to take out. And you have, yeah, I forgot to mention that. You have one screw that sits on the back here, down here. So it's actually, you can see there, I took the nut out. It is a 10 as well. You need an extension in order to get to it. And the screw, once you take it out, looks like this. I have it here somewhere. There you go. This is the one. Okay, so that screw here is holding the your air box, so your air filter, to the battery case, right? So you have to take this out before you can take the actual battery holder out. So let me just remove this now. There you go, it comes out pretty easily once everything's out of the way. And why you need to take this out, it's a bit of a drag really to have to do this, but it will come really handy because it will give you access to the nut and to the actual contact that we're trying to replace. That we now can see pretty easily. It's actually down there here. So again, I'm gonna just grab the camera here. Just gonna show you where this thing is. So it's down there, right? You can see it pretty well here. So at that point, it gets pretty easy really. The easiest way is to actually remove the connector. Now, this connector's got a little lock on the side, and it's kind of hard to show. Unless if I show you on the new one, you'll get a better sense of what this looks like. The new contact is here. This is it. This one is actually built a little bit differently. On the one that I'm going to take out, you'll see that there is an actual locking mechanism in place. So let me take this out, you'll get a better sense of what I mean. So it will take just a minute. It's fairly quick. I'm just going to disconnect the cable right now. There you go. Just popped it out. It's pretty easy. Got an adjustable wrench. You'll just need to actually untighten it. It can be pretty tight, and it's meant to be pretty tight. In fact, there is some thread lock on it to prevent it from untightening and from loosen up. It is actually bolted right on the transmission, around the gearbox, so it's something that you really want to, you have to be careful when you take this out because, like I said, it gets pretty tricky. Let me get a little bit closer here so you get a better sense of what I'm doing. And contact is actually down there. Let me get a little closer even if I can. There you go. So this is here, right here. So I'm just gonna unscrew it. You have to be very careful not to put any dirt or debris or anything in there. You see the thread is actually turning blue. I'm gonna show this to you in a moment. I'm almost there, there you go. So it is blue. It is blue because you got some thread locker on it, right? So that's the reason why. This is actually designed to hold the part in place so that it doesn't go away, right? So this one is defective. I'm just gonna discard that one for now. Put it on the side. And I'm gonna grab the connector because this little locking part that I was telling you about actually is on that side, is on the connector itself, right? So let me just actually adjust the light here. There we go. So on that side, you have a little piece of plastic that slides in when I'm gonna grab the new one and actually plug it in. And you'll see there's it's keyed actually. You can't really go wrong with that. It's pretty easy because one of the ends here is squarish, so it goes right in. And you see there's a little tooth here, right? There's a little locking mechanism. Not sure whether you can see this. Yeah, it shows pretty easily. Then you plug this in, should plug in all the way. And then that little tab here goes in there. Right? This is where it was when I took it out. And there's a way to get this done, yeah. I think. I just remember how that thing goes. It used to go like this, actually. But for some reason, there's nothing really holding it in place. I don't know why. Because on the other one, it did come off pretty easily. I'm not even sure whether that thing's got any kind of a function. I'm just gonna try to place it back in there. Yeah, it looks like it's not really doing anything. So I'm not exactly sure whether I'm gonna even reuse this because apparently there's if I'm missing another piece that fell off, which is a possibility because it's pretty intricate in this area, so I might not have seen it. But this is the old one, it's the same thing, so I'm just gonna discard this one here. Again, that's the old part, this is the new part. I'm just gonna place it on there, lock it in all the way. This nail is kind of, it's not as loose, so maybe that's the way it goes. In fact, I think it might be the way it goes, but let me just take this out to be on the safe side. So I'm just going to plug this back in. There you go. Make sure it's there all the way. You will be testing it anyways before you close everything back up. And that little thing here right now is holding in place, but it's, I don't think it's doing much really. In fact, I think it might have broken off the actual connector. That's a possibility. Well, at the moment it is holding. So the way I pulled this out earlier was that I actually used a little screwdriver to release this piece. Now, I mean, by doing so, I might actually have broken it off altogether. And that's a possibility. In which case, then, this might happen to you. Now, I don't think this piece is really required at the moment. I'm just going to take this out again. Just need to use a screwdriver. Lift it up, and that's exactly what I did actually when I took it out, and chances are that might be what actually broke it. In fact, looking at the connector, yeah, it's definitely broken. So that piece is not supposed to break off, right? So if you pay attention, you might be a little bit more careful than I was, and you'll be able to actually remove this and without breaking the little latch on the connector. So make sure you actually clean up the thread. Just blow on it, make sure there's no dirt. I should use some thread locker. It's downstairs actually, I don't think it's gonna go anywhere really. I'm just gonna tighten up nice and easy, but you can use some blue thread locker. It's pretty easy, you just put one drop in there. In fact, I'm just gonna go get it real quick, to be on the safe side. Alright, got the thread locker. Didn't take me too long. So, this is it, right? It's the blue. So, it's medium strength. You really don't need anything stronger than that. Because you might actually need to remove it again in the future. Hopefully not, but that might happen. Just put a drop on there. Really don't need much at all. Acts like a glue, if you will. But it's removable, that's the good thing. And then we're gonna go put it back in there. So go underneath the wires, it's the easiest way to do it, and then just place it back in there. Screw it in. You'll feel all resistance as you get to the blue part. It gets a little harder. In fact, I can't even screw it by hand right now. I have to use my wrench to adjust it. It's a pretty intricate area, so definitely not the easiest one to get to, but you should be able to get to it. Sorry, my arm is in the way, but really I have no option here. Okay. Surprised actually, the other one wasn't that hard to put back in. I know I'm in the thread, so that's not the problem. It's just the thread locker might be doing its job here, although it takes a few minutes to dry out. So okay, almost there. It's engaged. A few more rounds. I should be good. It's unfortunate because the previous one I was able to basically bring it up all the way to the edge. This one is not collaborating. Okay, and again, it's a pretty concise space, or intricate space. It's kind of hard to even get a wrench in there. Okay, almost done. Okay, one more spin. Longer than I anticipated. There you go. Okay, so now it's tight. So this is good. New sensor, or the new one is in place. Probably didn't see much of what I did, but it is in there, right here. So what we're gonna do now is grab the contact right here, and we're gonna plug it back in. So again, make sure that you put it back the right way. There's really not a lot of ways you can put it anyways. And here I'm gonna put back the little latch here. I'm really not sure whether this is doing anything, to be quite frank, but since I broke it up, I'm gonna put it back in there. It's gonna hold the vibration of the engine. We'll probably take it off, but that's okay. All right, so that's the hard part, really. So it's getting to the contact and actually removing it and replacing it. It's really not that complicated at the end. It's just a pain in the butt because there's not a lot of space, and like I said, there's not a lot of room to work. So on that side, let me actually move this back up a bit. On that side here, this is the actual battery holder. So that battery holder has got the grooves on the back. This is going to be used with this part that you must have taken out at the beginning, which kind of is used to guide the wires, right? So the guide actually goes in there and locks the cables in place. So it should go, whoops, the other way actually. It goes like this and slides in. Okay, so you take it out, goes back in. You have to actually make sure you match the notches, and the wires basically come out of there, right? So these, all the bunch of wires that we saw earlier, right? The red wires. So we're gonna take this out for now. We don't need it. And we're gonna put this back where it belongs. I'll just adjust the light a little bit. So we gotta make sure the cables are out of the way. And pretty certain this is gonna solve the problem. So that's the reason why I'm not testing it just now, because quite frankly, I actually did test it earlier and everything was working fine. So I know for a fact this is what the problem is with this backup light. Now, naturally, you want to do your due diligence to ensure that you've tested the bulbs and the lights on the back, and make sure that you've got everything covered, because you don't want to go through all this mess. If it's just a burnt pair of bulbs, it's just not worth it, right? So you have to line up the holes. So this is a bit of a pain. You have to ensure also, let me actually take this off again. So a couple things. You have to make sure the holes are lined up here so that you can put the screws back in there, right? So you have two screws here, two screws there, four. You also have to ensure that the airbox is on top of the battery housing. So might need to actually wiggle things around a little bit and ensure that this airbox, there you go, is actually lined up properly. Right? So once you have this, you're in pretty good shape. You really want to put these screws first, obviously, because this is what's kind of holding everything together. So I got this here. I put a little bit of WD-40 here to hold everything in place. Let me just make sure you can still see things. Okay, there you go. So put a couple of screws there. Remove all the dirt if you have excessive dirt in there. Right, put one screw in. Tighten it. Line up the other ones so that you have something that's easy to put back in. You guys will see better here. Okay, there you are. And then put the second one. It should actually come in really easily, because if your holes are lined up properly, then that should go in really easy. Just manually tighten these bolts. I don't know what the torque is really, quite frankly, but it doesn't really matter. It's you have four screws, just make sure they're tightened, because it is holding the battery in place, right? So you want to make sure that this is holding properly. That's number three. There you go. And that's number four. Okay. So it's pretty easy. That's a fairly easy part, really. Good, the washer underneath is not moving anymore. So this is in place. Now, remember that I showed you earlier, not sure whether you remember that, let me show you again. The wire is actually running in the back just like so, right? So the whole thing that I was showing you earlier, that little thingy here, goes in the back, right? So you have to make sure this is lined up properly. A bit of a pain to put back, quite frankly. But once it's in the groove, it goes in pretty easily. I think that's in. Not quite. Missed the two grooves in the lower part. There you go. So engage it from the back, from the lower part down, and make sure it's lined up properly. And this is going to guide your wires nicely into the space. Now, still need to put that bolt back in here, which is holding the air box to the battery. It's gonna be hard for me to show you, but fundamentally, it's pretty easy, really. You use an extension. You can use an extension. That's probably the easiest way to do it. Or if you have a screwdriver like this, that might actually do the trick. Pop the nut in there on the screw. Guide it all the way down if you can. Because if you lose it, just like I did, it's a pain in the butt to retrieve. And I got lucky here, managed to take it back. So try to guide it in. If it doesn't go in, or if you're having difficulty getting to the hole, so there you go, it's actually in right now. You might want to use a bit of a plastic maybe, a piece of soft plastic or plastic bag or something, put it on the head of the screw and then jam it in there so that this is actually holding the screw in place so that you can guide it into the hole. So everything looks good here. Screw is back in. Everything is nice and tight. We're just going to put the battery back in now. It's a pretty easy step again. Grabbing the battery, making sure all the wires are out of the way. Go. Make sure your plastic is out of the way as well, because that will get jammed in pretty easily. Okay, that looks nice. Okay, it's good. I'm just gonna connect the polarities. Just do a safety check here, and make sure that the backlights are actually working. So let me share this moment with you. Hopefully it's gonna work, because otherwise that might not be a bad surprise. That won't be a good surprise. Okay, so we should see some light coming out. Help. Perfect. Oh, that's fantastic. Lights are working, which is what we want. So the problem is technically solved. What we need to do now is continue to put this back. So I'm just gonna continue this. As you can tell, it's not fully done. Still have a little bit of work here. It's gonna be pretty quick, really. So this is attached to there. So that slides in there, right? So that thing here, you'll see, slides into notches that are underneath here. These two, one here, one here. And these two tabs are sliding in there. There you go. And it should actually assemble as such, and it kind of swivels up and down, right? You have to ensure that this is clipped on properly, right? So this assembly here clips on that bracket. And then this locks on both sides so that it doesn't go up, right? So at that point, we have everything connected, ensure that everything is locked in properly. I'm gonna tighten the bolts here. I'm gonna do this right now. It's pretty quick, really. Tighten that side. I'm going to do this at the very end. Actually, I'm doing this now because I'm a little tired. It's been a long day. And I'm gonna put the clip back on. So that clip is a bit of a problem to some extent because it's tucked in there, right? You might be able to see it. There you go. So it's tucked right in there. I put a bit of light, you'll see it right away, right? In fact, just move this back a bit. There you go. You can see it really well right now. So this hole, I have to put the screw back in there. So that's the reason why, actually, initially, we've removed the case, if you will, or the plastic casing that's behind the headlight. It's because that screw is at an angle, right? And it gets rusty really quickly, as you can tell. This screw is actually in pretty bad shape, but it's good enough, really, as long as you have a good bit to grab onto it. So this is when you need the extension, because you need to reach. This is a 13 metric extension. On Volkswagens, you will find this very often. It is very often metric, more often than not. That bracket goes down there. You have to make sure you don't drop it, because that's a serious pain if you drop it. So it goes down there, and there's a little groove that will actually get into a notch that's right on the battery itself. So you can't really go wrong with this. And then you just put it back in. And it should go back very easily. This extension I have here is probably about 10 inches, probably more than that, like probably a foot long. And as you can tell, it's at an angle, right? You might not be able to tell this, but it's actually at an angle. And you want to ensure, so before you tighten it, make sure the little bracket thing is actually engaged on the battery, which is the case here. And then tighten it. Not too much, it doesn't have to be tightened too much, really. But tightening in to ensure that the battery is not moving at all. And we're done with that extension ratchet. So at that point, we're left off with just two things. It's always a good thing to actually put things back together and realize that there is no screws left over or anything. This is the light case that actually goes right on top. So let me actually go back to my view earlier. It might actually be a little bit easier for you guys. There you go. So that bracket goes right here on top, right there. So you slide it in, and again, you have guides. You have to ensure that this actually clips at the bottom, you'll find that there's a little clip. Let me take this out for a second again. There's a clip down there. As you can tell, you have a like a slit, if you will. Let me grab a screwdriver so I can show you a little bit better. Right here. So this, the case that I'll just show you here, will slide in these notches here, right? And you actually have slanted teeth here that will guide it in and will keep it in alignment. Same thing applies on that side. Whoops, a little lanyard here in the way. There's a slit right there, and the case, the piece of plastic will actually slide in there. So just grab it. You also have actually a couple of teeth on the bracket itself, and you have a little handle to pull out on it, right? So it goes vertically as such, and you slide it in. So you have to ensure that you're in the slit on that side. There's another slit on the other side. You have to make sure there's no cable in the way. And that thing should go down pretty easily, although at times it can be a little tricky because these things do bend out of shape occasionally. So let's make sure that this is lined up properly, and it's not going in nicely here. Not too sure why. Let me actually put the camera back on because I need both hands here. So, there's more screws. We'll check what is going on that side. It should go down fairly easily. This cable, which actually will trigger the lock for your hood, might also get in the way, so just be careful. And this should go down fairly easily, although that particular piece is not collaborating. And I'm not too sure why, in fact. So I'm not sure whether there's something in the way here. It's always when you think it's over and that the hardest part is done, then you end up with a stupid piece of plastic that just won't get in. Okay, let me try that again. Okay, this gets in the way. Oh, that's what the problem is. That is in the way. Okay, so that thing here is being a bit of a problem. Unexpected, in fact, okay, because I need a little bit more loose, which seems to solve the problem here. So, in fact, I don't have to push it all the way down, really. There we go. That's better. Now, it does not really lock in there for some odd reason, but I am, as far as I can get, really. This is in contact here. Down there, it's not fully engaged for some reasons. But I don't think I'll be able to get any further. This is the plastic piece that this guides into. It is a little bit bent out of shape, and it's not really collaborating. So what you want to make sure is that there is a little rubber pad there. I'm kind of wondering whether this is even running the right way at the moment. And this might be off a little bit, but you want to ensure that this rubber pad is actually not jamming this on top. Maybe I'll have to take a look at this when I close the hood. But right now, this is the best I can put this, and quite frankly, I don't think there's any other way you can put it in. So from what I can see, that's how it's supposed to go. Put the two screws. They're just Phillips screws. Nothing really fancy about the screws. Just gonna find the right bit here. Had the bit earlier. That's, there you go. So that's one. Make sure they're lined up, because otherwise it's gonna be more difficult to put in. You don't have to over tighten this, There is a staple underneath, like a metal staple that should keep it there. But occasionally they do break off, especially if the car is old, just like this one here. And so we're all good here. And the last thing to do is just putting the plastic case back on, lock it in, and you're in business. Now, what I was telling you earlier is to check whether this little tab here, this is a little nut actually at the very top here. It's not a nut, it's more of a rubber, nipple basically that dampers the fall of the hood when you close it. Now that little thing, let me just take this off for a sec. Well, actually probably land in this area, right? And what I'm seeing is that this cable is actually kind of in the way, because I think the nipple probably ends up here, if I look at this. And so I want to make sure this is not jamming the cable, because this will ultimately snap and break off and cause other issues, although at the moment I just don't see where that thing can run outside of where it is right now. So it looks like it's in the way, but I just don't know whether this is going to be a problem or not. So I'm going to take a look at it real quick. Just going to lower this and double check where this ends up being. And yeah, that looks like it's going to be just right on the cable or right next to it. So I think this little landing pad here that you see in the little circular spot is probably the area where you have to make sure the cable is kind of staying clear off of that, because otherwise it will probably get jammed onto it. So this is it. I'm just going to take a screwdriver out of here, double check that everything's good. Yep, it's good. It's kind of dusty, but there's not much you can do. I spoke to a guy actually at Volkswagen and suggested not to shampoo these engines. You probably heard that before. Not a good idea. Lots of contacts, lots of switches and electronic, and it's just not a good idea to do it. So it's been like this for a while, and it's probably going to remain like this for another number of years. So I'll just close this. Closes, no problem. And this is it. So I hope this is this little how-to is going to help a few people out there. I might edit it a little bit, because it's about 37 minutes long right now. If you're patient, just jump through the video and you'll be fine. Thanks for watching. Bye.